Hey guys, today I'm going to go over the Winsor & Newton pigment markers, which are a new product from Winsor & Newton, as well as test several papers to see how well they work for them. This is an augmentation of my blog, Natto Soup, which is www.nattosoup.blogspot.com. You can find the link below, and ideally there's an annotation here to help direct you. I just thought it would be maybe easier to do it on video rather than taking a million pictures and then uploading a million pictures and editing a million pictures and writing for a million pictures. I thought a video would be easier. So first off, I'm going to show you guys the Winsor & Newton pigment markers I have. As of right now, if you're ordering a set of six, like I have a set of six skin tones that I ordered pretty much as soon as I found out these markers were out from Dick Blick, and they've gone on back order twice. I'm not going to see them until November 23rd, which isn't exactly cool by my book. I wish I had known that at the time of purchase, but you can't control shipments. You are, however, able to buy most of those colors open stock, which is a little weird to me that your set won't come in, but you can overpay for individual markers. Sorry, gripe over. And as you can see, I have a fair variety, minus the skin tones. I have the white pigment marker, which you guys have seen me, I'm sorry, the white blender, which you guys have seen me use on a couple of illustrations. I have the colorless blender, and I have a fair selection of colors. I would ideally wanted to hold off all of my tests until my skin tone set came in, but it kept getting pushed back and pushed back. It kind of ruined my review plans. So I'm going to do the best that I can, and rather than drawing Kara for you guys, I'm actually going to illustrate a bouquet because that takes advantage of the colors I do have. These markers are alcohol-based pigment markers, which I think makes them the first alcohol-based pigment markers, but they're also water-soluble, which makes it extremely difficult to find a pen you can use with these, or at least it's made it difficult for me to find a pen I can use with these on Yupo, which was the paper that was recommended to me by one of the Winsor & Newton reps at Hands On Creativity at my local Plaza art supply store. I have some of Winsor & Newton's marker paper coming in the mail. This whole review has been a series of goofs because apparently their address system lost my address, so I had to resubmit my address so I could get a sample of the paper, which isn't out in stores yet. So unfortunately I can't go over that paper in this video because I don't have it, the same way I can't go over the skin tones in this video because I don't have it, but I can go over several other papers that I have lying around and that you might have lying around. So I kind of did my best guesses what would work. So I have Strathmore Mixed Media Board 500 series, which has been kind of sitting around my apartment for a while. So this is a fine time to use it. I have a Copic PM pad, which in regards to Copic papers I like because it's a little bit translucent, but it is not an it doesn't absorb the ink as well as other papers, which actually might work well for the pigment markers because one of the problems I've had with it in my sketchbook is that I can't get the colors to do anything other than just sit on top of each other. I have this cute little Deleter sketchbook, which I got in Japan several years ago and I'd like to use. And it's got a heavier paper. It's kind of, it's like a thinner Bristol, kind of like a cardstock with a texture. I have 400 series mixed media paper. I have wood pulp based watercolor paper. I have marker board. I have some of this distressed watercolor cardstock, which I'm going to do other tests on it too. I have my suspicions about it, but I'm not going to spoil them here. I have Yupo, and as you can see, I've already tested several pens with the Yupo. I've done tests with the colorless blender as well as with just plain water. And like I said earlier, it's really difficult. I couldn't find anything that actually wouldn't smear with when you add the alcohol-based marker. The closest I came was the Maxon Pro Color 2. Oh, and this is giving the markers the pen ink 24 hours to cure, which you should do if you can. And I do it for all of my tests. I never apply color directly because it will smear. Even with that 24-hour dry time, the Maxon Pro Color 2 smeared. It didn't smear as badly, but it still makes me kind of hesitant to apply color on top of it, especially since the ink could ruin your nibs, and the nibs on the Winsor & Newton pigment markers are not replaceable, and they're not refillable. Crescent render paper, which is supposed to be a good paper for markers, and translucent Yubo, which I thought, since I can't find a pin that will work, what I'm probably going to have to do to render with pigment markers on Yubo is I'm probably going to have to use a light box, and I thought the translucent paper might, and composite everything together in Photoshop. And I thought the translucent Yubo might make that a little bit easier because I could just maybe slide the inks underneath and work directly. Some other papers that I'll probably end up testing but are not part of this video are Strathmore 500 series plate Bristol, which I often use for Copic markers, and cardstock, another thing that I often use for Copic markers, and Winsor & Newton's marker paper, which I don't have yet. So let's get started. So in several of the reviews for Yubo watercolor paper on Amazon, they say that the oils in your hands will make it harder to render on this kind of paper, and they recommend you wipe it down with rubbing alcohol. And I have a spray bottle of like 90% rubbing alcohol that I use for art purposes, but I can't find it, so I raided my medicine cabinet for some rubbing alcohol. I just want to give the markers the best chance. Oh, you can see my fingerprints. Well, I can see my fingerprints where I'd held the paper. And I'm not super sure how I'm going to render on this paper without it putting more fingerprints on. Fingers, oils. I just took a bath, so my hands are pretty clean. And I'm rubbing them down with the rubbing alcohol because, try to take the precautions that I can. And now I need to dry it. And I should say right now that I'm not a Winsor & Newton rep. They are not a sponsor of my blog. I'm not a Yubo rep. They are not a sponsor of my blog. These materials, for the most part, were purchased out of my own pocket. Although I will say, the Winsor & Newton rep at Hands-On Creativity did give me like 3 of the markers that had been on the table for demonstration to take home to help with the review. So I appreciate that. Thank you, Ray. But other than that, it's been everything is paid for out of my own pocket, or with your very generous donations. But mostly through my own pocket. So you guys can't see the bouquet I have on the screen, and I'm just gonna try and loosely render it. So these markers are twin tipped, not refillable, can't replace the nibs, as I've mentioned. They have a bullet nib and a chisel nib, and I have already written to them about maybe having a brush nib instead of a bullet nib, because bullet nibs are horrible, in my opinion, or offering both. And I'm sure other artists have said as much. So I'm going to be rendering today with the bullet nib, just because it's a little bit softer and more forgiving than the chisel nib. And Yubo is a synthetic paper. It's made out of plastic. It's like a polyurethane paper. And already you can see these markers are very eager to blend. So that's cool. You don't even need to use their colorless blender to do that. On Yubo, it's a little bit harder to get them to layer. Yubo takes a little bit longer to dry because it won't absorb the ink. And I'm working kind of fast because I have a lot of papers to cover, and I have some good friends coming to visit, and I'd like to get this mostly out of the way before they come, because they might be sleeping in my studio. Maybe not. Maybe I'll make them sleep downstairs. It's always hard giving up your studio, even to people you love, because you can't, I can't work other in anywhere else. Like, studio has exactly the kind of lighting I like. It's got snacks. It's got my coffee machine up here. Like, it's really a hardship when I sound so spoiled. I am really spoiled. It's hard for me to give it up. When I was a girl, I would draw anywhere. I had one of those clipboards that had the... I didn't really have, like, a lot of free time, especially as a teenager, because my brother was involved in sports, and I was involved in, like, choir, stuff like that. So my free time at home was minimal, and I got really good at doodle... Well, I won't say good. I wasn't very good at drawing, but I... It was no problem for me to, pick up my work and go elsewhere. I also worked much more modestly. I drew entirely on cardstock with, like, Zig Millennium pins. Okay, so... So far, that's a daisy. I guess I'm gonna wait. It takes forever to dry. But I guess I'm gonna wait a little while on that flower and, like, render some of the other stuff. I'm gonna get really good at drawing this bouquet by the time I'm finished going through all these papers. I do actually draw a lot of flower stuff. If you follow my Instagram or my Facebook page, which is Natto Soup, you can see that. It's pretty apparent. So this isn't, like, a hardship for me. I'm not like, But I mean, I do think, for me, because I'm a comic artist, my comics are not just flowers. That would be cool, but they're not just flowers. I think drawing people is kind of, like, the true test for me, for whether a marker or a paper really suits my needs. It's cool how quick, how gestural they blend. This would, if I was trying to render a person consistently over time, this would drive me nuts. But, gotta change how you think about things. So the center of the flower here is dry, and I'm trying to add some detail. I mean, it does, it layers okay. This mum looks ridiculous, like, really bad. Just kind of exploded over there, I guess. It's also a little harder for me to just, like, doodle, especially on camera, where people are gonna see and people are gonna judge my artistic abilities, because I am a very methodical person. I'm not a natural artist. Like, I'm not, I mean, if you read the blog, if you know me, I think art draftsmanship is a skill that can be taught, but I also know people who have, like, more natural ability than I do. They learn, they pick things up much quicker. And that's not an excuse to not try or to give up, throw in the towel. Oh, well, so-and-so's so much better than me. Like, that's not what I'm suggesting. I'm just, like, suggesting that I had to teach myself how to render figures and stuff in a very specific way in order to get good results. And sometimes it's really hard for me to, like, let that go. And right now, it's kind of hard for me to let that go. Let it go and just be okay with how rough everything's gonna end up being. I mean, it is just a field test. It's not, like, I'm not doing this for anybody, but you guys, to see how these markers work, decide if you like them, to find papers that work well for me and might work well for you, give you some ideas, maybe get you excited about experimenting around. So, that's the joys of Ebo. And there are artists who love, like, I'm not slamming Ebo, there are artists who love Ebo, they love painting on it, they can get way better things than I can. Like, everything I do on Ebo looks horrible. So, something that's kind of cool about these markers is, let me find a not alcoholy bit of this Viva paper towel. See how the nib is getting kind of dirty? Well, you can brush the dirt out onto the paper towel, the color, the other pigments. So as long as what's in your marker is other pigment marker, you should be okay. It's not going to ruin it forever. I mean, I'm sure if I got like black on the yellow, when I got this yellow, it had like a bunch of azure blue in it, and I cleaned it all out. So maybe even if you had black in it, it would come out. Might be too wet to really put down any pigment. So, and I'd love, I'd also like to try stone paper. And I went to Jerry's Artorama for like a Halloween party they were hosting. And while I was there, I looked for stone paper and I couldn't find it. And I know it exists. Like I see it in like the Dick Blick catalog, that kind of stuff. I just need to order it online, I guess. Because I looked at Plaza and I couldn't find it there either. Stone paper is less, it doesn't absorb as much as like regular wood pulp or cotton-based paper. I think it might absorb a little bit more than Yubo, which, I mean, nothing soaks in. At best, you're going to get some staining. Don't have a black, and I don't think my purple is dark enough to really do good highlights. And these markers don't have an overwhelmingly strong smell of alcohol, if that's something you are concerned about. I think a lot of parents are, or people, artists with sensitive noses, artists with allergy issues. I know sometimes Shinhan Twin Touch markers make me sick. Like the fumes give me a headache. Oh, yellow is not dry. Oh. In fact, I was honestly surprised when I found out that these markers were alcohol-based because they react so weirdly. I mean, weird and kind of like a, I've never seen this before, and I review a bunch of alcohol-based markers kind of way. And then they said these were water-soluble too, and I from an artist standpoint, I get it, because I'm like, okay, yeah, because they're pigment-based, so the water's going to disperse the pigment. That's kind of cool, and I'm going to have to show you guys. I haven't done it. I haven't played with that at all yet. I've been like holding off so I could do it on video because I feel like video is going to be easier for me and maybe for you. For my readers who have said they don't really like video, I'm sorry. I'm going to try and include text so you guys can follow along. It's just that stuff with this, it's like this, it's so immediate that it's kind of hard for me to pull out the camera. And like that's something I've been struggling with, is with immediate media that dry really quickly. I can't capture what it's doing in a way that you guys can see it. So moving to video seemed like a good solution for that. So I apologize to my constant readers, bless you guys, who are gonna see that this post is a lot of video, and they're gonna be like, I can't consume it. I'm gonna try and meet you in the middle on that. Cause I started out that way too. Like, I don't know. I've gotten a lot better. Like I watch a lot of reviews and I read a lot of reviews when I'm preparing for these kind of things. Because I want to give you guys the best information I can, and I want to credit, if I can, I want to credit the people who said it. That's something that kind of bothers me, is that I see other content creators, They'll just like drop, oh yeah, I saw it on the internet, and then not give you a place to look it up. Like, you can go to the Yupo review page, and you'll see where several people talking about, I'm sorry, I don't remember your names, but you'll see several people talking about cleaning your Yupo first so that the media you're using adheres to it. I don't know, I think in art supply review of anything, if you got information from another source, I think you really should credit them. I mean, not only does it introduce your audience to people who are serving their needs, so you're helping your own audience, but you're helping that creator as well, because if you don't give them credit, you're just kind of stealing their knowledge, and you're not putting the work in, and that's not okay. That's not a sustainable art community, where some people become very big and very popular, but they have used other people's knowledge to get there without trying to help those people along the way. I don't know. I have a really fairy tale perception of the art and comic community. I want us all to rise together. So on the Yupo, blending is really, really, like, it's almost hard to layer because it blends so easily. I think that's cool. It gives it, and this looks rough, I apologize. It gives it a very painterly look, which I think some of you guys are gonna really like. And it's probably safe to say that if you already enjoy painting on Yupo, you will enjoy using alcohol inks and pigment inks on Yupo. Because I assume, looks-wise, they're very similar. I'm sure those of you who regularly use Yupo are probably like, you're working too fast. Yeah, wow. I don't want to spend 2 weeks recording the footage for this series. See, it would have helped so much if I could, like, use a pencil or something first. I just always have this need to sketch it out. I think I'm probably a little bit of a control freak. I like consistent results. I like to be, even for, like, techniques that are supposed to be a little more fluid, I like knowing the formula of how to get what I need. So I probably don't play around as much as I should. I mean, doing reviews for the blog has certainly encouraged me, certainly has forced me, given me the opportunity is the best way to say it, has given me the opportunity to try out all kinds of things that I might never have justified purchasing. I mean, for so many people, comics means black and white, and I actually do watercolor comics, which, I mean, that's like its own. I think that's also, oh, and I've used Copic for, like, illustration, both for my own, because I like Copics, I like alcohol markers, I like how that looks. I love translucent media, transparent media. I don't like acrylics. I mean, really, it's kind of like drawing with classy dry erase markers on a classy dry erase board. Kinda. seen some people do some pretty amazing things with dry erase markers, so that is no means a slam. It's just an observation. Because the pigment just sits on top. It can always be reactivated. I could probably take a wet... I mean, once this dries, I could take a wet brush, like a water brush, and just, like, smear all the colors. Maybe I will do that. Okay, so this is the white blender. I actually like using it for adding white highlights on toned paper, because you can do it very subtly, and I think it's a great looking effect. Problem with it, it's not a real problem, but since everything is darker than white, you have to clean it in order to get like a striking result. And I'm trying to do this on dry flowers that have finished drying. But I mean, because this is Yupo, it's always going to reactivate. Gosh, if I took a wet brush to this at any point, it would look... I mean, it's already rough, but it would look way worse. That's okay, we're playing around. We're learning what works. And we're learning it together. My video editor is going to be so annoyed with these, though. Maybe not so much. The watercolor marker video I did actually had a lot more editing than this is going to have. I'm going to just be like, well, it is what it is. I can't make it something it's not. I'm not gonna lie to you guys and like practice, and then be like, this is my first time. Nah. You guys, as much as it makes me cringe, because I've had, I'm sure every artist, especially comic artists with like a manga influence, right? I've certainly had my share of people saying really cruel things. So it always makes me a little bit hesitant to share my stuff, but I think it's important, and I think it's important to share the failures too, because people are looking at what you're doing and they're learning. And they can learn a lot from seeing you completely flub something up. I like seeing, I mean, it's not just like, it's not at all like a, when I say I love seeing other artists' failures, it's more like, it makes them human. It's like, oh, thank goodness. They have to work really hard at this too. Not everything looks amazing from them. Okay, so this is Winsor & Newton pigment markers on Yupo paper. It's still damp, so I'm gonna put it to the side and move on to the next paper. I might come back with this with like a wet water brush, or I might try to add some details later. We'll find out, we'll see. Next up is the render paper, which is supposed to be, you can use both sides, which is kind of unusual for marker paper. And to be quite honest, I don't use both sides in my sketchbooks. I only use the fronts. I don't like it smearing. I mean, they're cheap enough, like there's not really a good reason to be stingy with your sketchbooks. I know people who also draw on like reams of printer paper and it works really well. So that's an even cheaper way of doing it. But it's a heavyweight white paper, 110 pounds, which is pretty, it doesn't feel like 110 pounds, but that's a pretty heavy paper for like a marker paper. And it says you can use both sides, like I said, but I'm not going to. And look, use with all media. Oh, you can't see it. Use with all media. So surely we can use this with Winsor & Newton pigment markers, right? Well, I don't know. I bought this, I guess a year ago? Because I wanted to do like a alcohol-based marker test, and this is as fine a time as any to pull it out and mess around with it. Maybe it'll like kind of... Oh, this is like... It like soaks that ink up really quick. And this red is kind of messed up because it was one of the demo ones, and I think somebody... I mean, the cap for it was a blender cap. So I'm wondering if like some colorless blender soaked in, or if it's like running low because it was a tester model. I'm not complaining. It was free. I'm grateful for the donation. I just don't want you guys to see. Oh, you can barely see what I'm doing. I don't want you to see what I'm doing and judge the marker like it's like a brand new marker. So, it kind of, like me scrubbing back and forth like this. You can do this with Copics. You can do this with most alcohol markers. I haven't encountered too many with that you can't do it with. But like this scrubbing is kind of, I don't know, kind of, it makes me worry for like the paper's ability to withstand repeated mark making, which is always a concern for markers, and it's why I'm not testing these on Payson, because since these are pigment based, rather than dyed based like Copics or Shinhan Twin Touch or Prismacolors, they take a little bit longer to dry, and that makes the paper susceptible to tearing and pilling, because this is the nib, even the bullet nib would be even worse. The chisel nib is a little softer. This is why, one of the reasons I want a brush nib on these. But it's kind of tearing up the surface of the paper, which isn't good. And makes it harder to layer. And I'm not sure if it's the paper or if it's the marker or what. However, no bleed through yet. A plus. Good job, Render. Also, I mean, I'm getting some pretty gestural, expressive marks, even with the chisel nib, but you could get a more painterly effect with the combination of a chisel nib and a nice flexible brush nib. And I know Winsor Newton's watercolor markers have a brush nib. A brush nib and a bullet nib. And I really wish they had a brush nib and a chisel nib. But they don't. So sometimes I wish I could smoosh what I like about certain brands together to make like an ultimate marker. Actually going faster than I thought. I've only been recording the marker segment for 22 minutes. I totally was like, I bet I'm at like an hour now because I'm chattering away and having a good time. And that's when time flies for me. That's when I lose track of time really bad. It's when I'm having a good time. Especially if I'm messing around with art supplies. So these are far less likely to blend. I mean, let me zoom in. I mean, you're getting some yellow blending, but not, I mean, these are, on this paper, they're behaving less like gouache, if gouache was a marker, and more like an alcohol-based marker. And they're very interesting. As much as I've invested in them, and as much hype as I've been talking about them a lot on my Twitter and on my Instagram and sharing stuff that I've done on my Instagram, but as much as I've been doing those things, I'm not sure these markers really have a place in my current body of work. I might have to make a place. They're okay, they're fun, but they're not, it's not like I'm like so taken aback by my ability to render with these. Sorry. Maybe if I find a sketching tool, and I mean, I might be able to use, you would think that on this kind of paper, which is a marker paper that absorbs, this is the Crescent Render paper, you'd be able to use a normal inking implement. Anything that's both waterproof and alcohol-based marker proof should be good. So like the Sailor Mitsuo Ida which is both Copic and waterproof. It's like my favorite thing to ink things with because it's a brush pen and a Fude pen. So I'm very comfortable with that, and I can do that anywhere except like in a car because it's very compact. There's no mess. The only problem is I've only found them at JetPens. They're not easy. Like if I run out on a trip, I can't just, maybe I could go to like a Japanese stationery store if I'm fortunate enough to be near one. But in this part of the country, Tennessee, your chances of finding that are pretty slim. Normal art stores like Dick Lick, Jerry's Artarama, don't carry them. I mean, they've started carrying like Pentel Touch Fude pens, which is exciting because I've been inking with Fude pens for 5 years now, and it's the first time I've started to find them very easy to find in any brick and mortar store. But at least you can get them on Amazon now. So if you're a Prime member, you can get that 2-day delivery, which is great for emergencies. But you can't get the Mitsuo Aida on Amazon, unfortunately. Unfortunately for me, because I use Amazon affiliate and Blick affiliate to try and offset some of the cons of running a cons, geez, some of the costs of running an art supply review blog. It's actually very expensive. I know some bloggers get stuff sent to them. I am not one of the chosen few. But you guys could help fix that. You could write to companies and on my behalf and tell them how much you like my reviews and how helpful they are to you. And that would maybe hold more sway than the work itself. I mean, companies are not influenced by little bloggers like me. They're influenced by customers with spending money. And they've already got my money because I bought the product, so. I'm not really digging the render paper as a marker paper for the pigment markers. I might like it better for alcohol-based marker, like Copics and Prismacolors and Shinhan Twin Touch, but I don't like it for this. Although it doesn't bleed through, and that's cool. It means you can use both sides. I wouldn't. I would still just use one side. But for those card makers who are very concerned about having like a nice white back on their card, this could be a good paper for you because you don't have to put a backing paper on it. You got that nice, clean, white back. I don't care. I like, as picky as I can be, I like it when the hand of the artist is shown. When I buy commissions from other artists, I like seeing how they did things. So if somebody went and made me a beautiful handmade card, I would totally not even complain the least little bit about the marker showing through, but you know, if that's something that bothers you, this could be a really good paper for you because it's a heavier marker paper. But I'll revisit it later and let you guys know how it handles not pigment based markers. I mean, and you can still get some blending, just not as much as I'd hoped. I was hoping like it would be like pushing paint around, I think, which would make it almost entirely useless for my normal studio needs, but it would make it really cool and very different from what's currently being offered. And I'm always super excited about those kind of products. Because, I mean, it seems like every company right now has an alcohol-based marker. You're spoiled for choice. I've reviewed so many of them. And most of them kind of are the same. They use the same kind of body and the same kind of nibs, and they're just, this kind of boring. So when a company introduces something that is even a little bit different, and these are a lot different, just not, on render paper, not as different as I'd hoped, that's always really exciting for me. I mean, for me, it's, you never really know when you're gonna hit on something that just completely changes your art or inspires you to go in other directions or gives you another avenue to make a living, which is hard as an illustrator and an artist. With bills to pay and cat mouths to feed and your own mouth to feed. You know, I'm always looking for non-fan art things that I can do that are different to make my work stand out in the artist alley or to try and impress clientele with a little bit more spending money or who might be more interested in, like, purchasing commissions of their family members, stuff like that. It's a little more sustainable. I don't have the energy to be to make comics and do children's book illustrations and then go do cons and make con merch and try and stay on top of all of the really, I mean, they're really cool. There's like lots of really cool things you can get made, you can order to sell at your table with your art on it. I'm not slamming that at all, but I don't know. I have like con mode and comic artist mode, and the past 2 years have been con mode, so I'm ready to go back to comic artist mode. So I'm not really digging the render paper. I think I mentioned that to you guys like 6 times. Not digging it for this. This application is not my ideal render paper application. I mean, like, the page is still damp, even though these are alcohol-based markers. It's tacky to the touch. I'm not getting the kind of blending I thought. The paper is kind of pilling. And it could be, like, the pigments accumulating on the paper and kind of abrading the paper. That's a thing it could be. It could be the paper is just not designed for these kind of markers, and that's why Winsor & Newton is going to all the trouble of releasing a paper that's specific for these markers. Oh, excuse me. So look what came in from UPS. Twix candy, fun size bars. It's October 29th, and I live in an area that doesn't really get trick-or-treaters. So, I'm probably gonna eat these by myself because Kit Kats and Twix are my favorite! I mean, like, super favorite candy. I'm really bad about it, in fact, because if I have a bag of candy around, I'll eat it for lunch! Because it's easier than going downstairs and cooking, and I'm hungry right now. And that's why I put like some in the shot. There's 4 of them. 4 is probably excessive to normal people who don't eat candy as food, but I am a 6-year-old child in an adult body with adult autonomy. So I can eat candy for lunch if I want to, and then get cranky and sick later if I want to. But it's Halloween, so I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna eat the candy for lunch. And, like, just talking about candy for lunch is making me hungry. Alright, so that's the render paper. Not really super duper awesome for Winsor & Newton pigment markers. Yes, I did just take a Twix. Next up, Crescent Marker Board, which I had purchased for, sort of the same reason I purchased the render paper. to review as its own product. Oh my goodness. Twix are so good. Mm. Oh, fancy. And I got them on sale at David Art Supply in New Orleans when I was visiting my family for MechaCon. And you get three sheets, and it's kind of like a cardstock. Actually, it's heavier than that. It's like illustration board. And I think I thought this was going to be great for commissions, and it very well might be. And it's by Crescent, who makes Render. So the problems I have with Render are probably going to be the problems I have with this. I can't get it open. I don't have nails anymore. I bite my nails. Oh, hey. You'd almost think I was an artist, right? I'm going to try to do it on camera. Not because, like, I need you to see, but not because I need you to see how annoying it is to open these. Although that's a thing. It's more like, I don't know. I don't like it when YouTubers, like, disappear from the camera for, like, 10 minutes while they're opening something. It's like, no, I need to see you struggle. I'm a terrible person. It's just, I don't know, it's like part of the show, you know? It's part of the song and dance. So, it's render board, and, not render board, I'm sorry. Crescent marker board. It's kind of thick. It would be good for commissions if it works. Like, I would be excited to get a little commission on heavy board like that. Because it won't curl with the humidity. It's less likely to. I mean, it might. That would be sad, wouldn't it? Like, you know, you have this, like, heavy marker paper and it still curls in the humidity. It's kind of like, what's the point? I'm basically rendering the same cluster of flowers over and over again. Partially for consistency's sake. Partially because I'd like to actually get better at drawing these stupid flowers. It's like bugging me that they are not turning out very well. Taking it personally. How dare you? I paint and I draw flowers all the time. I picked these because I thought I'd be good at it. I actually wanted the bright colors, and also I thought I would be good at it. The hubris. I think my venial sins are jealousy and hubris. Those are the ones I'm going down for. I try really hard. I repeat that comparison is the thief of joy all the time. But you can know something in your head and it not make a bit of difference. Wow, that looks bad, right? That is a bad one. Not great. It really helps for me to sketch them out. So if you are following along at home and you're like, man, my freehand drawing looks terrible, you're not alone. My freehand drawing looks really bad too. And I've been doing this for a really long time. So you'd think I'd be a little bit better at this whole freehand drawing thing. But no. Not with markers. I'd like to be. Color blocking is cool. I have respect for the people who can do it. I can't. Wow. I mean, really. That's like a special flower. The most beautiful flower in the bunch. I mean, it's just something. So, this is a little less, so far, a little less prone to pilling than the render paper. Still, you can't see it. Maybe if I zoom in, you can see it. It's pooling. No, you can't, but it's... Let me see if I can catch the reflection. Yeah, you see that little sparkle? I didn't put glitter on it. It's wet, which for alcohol markers, like, come on, dry. You're supposed to be dry by now. Sorry for the glare. And that wetness is actually what makes water-based markers kind of a pain in the booty to use, because it means the paper is going to get chewed up by your nibs. And I've kind of like mushed I've kind of mushed these a bit because I've been using them. So they're a little softer and less prone to ripping things up. But you're straight out of the box, straight out of the store. Markers might not be pre-loved, and they might be a problem. See, mushed. It's okay. It would be super duper cool if these were refillable and replaceable nibs. Hint, 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 hint. But that might not actually be possible. It'd be cool though. I'd like them better. Mostly because then I could replace the bullet nib that I'm not going to use because it's going to eat up anything but Yubo. So what do you guys like to draw? You should totally comment. Or what would you like to see me draw? You should... email me, maybe. if you have suggestions for things you'd like to see, you can throw fan art at me. Right now, there's no promise that I'm going to get to it, but I might. I mean, even if it's something that is totally different from anything you've seen me do, I mean, you can watch me try. It might turn out good. It'll be fun. I actually really like art challenges a lot. I pick one each month. Right now I'm doing Inktober. And I try to, like, for example, for Inktober, I don't normally ink with a brush anymore because the only reason I was inking with a brush was when I was at SCAD to get better at inking with a brush because I was horrible at it. And because the only ink I knew of at the time that was Copic marker proof that wasn't Sakura Microns or Copic Multiliner Tech Pens was Kaimei Soul K ink, which is Copic proof, and so I thought I had to use a brush to do it. But I mean, inking with a brush is a nice, it's a good skill to have, and it's actually very relaxing once you get good enough at it that you don't hate every line you put down. And I think it's more visually interesting to watch someone do it than it is to watch somebody use a tech pen or a Fude pen, which is what I would otherwise be using. It's what I use for my reviews, is Fude pens. Yeah, it's like, it's really, oh shoot, there we go, it's really gumming up my nib. I'm not sure if that's like the nib falling apart, or the pigment, or I think it's the nib falling apart. Wow, that's so sad. I'm not even scrubbing hard, and this paper doesn't have a surface. Come on, Winsor Newton. Is it the pigments? Do they make the nibs stay overly soft? Inquiring minds want to know. Is that the problem with brush? Like, why you guys haven't included a brush? Because testing showed that this was going to happen? I mean, I'm getting mine either at Plaza, so I'm paying like $5.20-something, or I'm getting them online at Dick Blick, where I'm paying $4.99. Which is still less than a lot of Copics, but it's still more expensive than a lot of other alcohol markers. And if you guys are going as cool as like working with pigment is, and as cool as the idea that these are water soluble so you can play with them more and blend them out with water, both very cool. I give you big props for that. As cool as that is, if these markers fall apart and you can't refill them, and you can't replace the nibs when the nibs fall apart and they chew up the paper. I mean, it's kind of like, I don't know. I was going to say like keeping a puppy in your dorm room, you know, like it seems like a good idea and you really want to like it, but after it's destroyed all your stuff and the hall monitor, gosh, I lived in a dorm for 5 years, so I should know, whatever. your adult type person is on to you. Like, you can't keep puppy anymore. You can't justify having puppy. Puppy's got to go live with your mom and dad. That's a terrible analogy, though. And I did not do that, although I really like dogs. And, that's all I got. But seriously, though, if your nibs are getting, torn up with normal use, and this is a chisel nib. Chisel nibs are kind of a workhorse color filler nib, you know? You apply huge areas of color with the chisel nib. And if it can't even handle, like, 5 flower drawings on smooth papers, it's kind of a problem. This might actually, as not cute as these flowers are turning out, these might actually be my most useful field tests because, I mean, I'm doing repetitive work with it, and we're finding out quick how bad wear and tear it goes. I know Winsor Newton sent out some samples to artists to noodle around with, but it looks like those artists did like their one illustration and that was that. And I mean, that's a great way to sell your product because the illustrations look great, but you can't tell what problems they had with the markers. So from an artist standpoint, while the illustrations are fun to look at, they're useful as a tool to determine for me, whether or not I'm going to buy the markers. I mean, clearly I bought the markers, but I was going to buy them anyway. I mean, when they said pigment marker and hinted at a mystery solution, mystery binder, I was sold. I was like, done. I got to know. I got to find out. I'm like, cat. And it's a box. I'm going to be in that box. You know I'm going to be in that box. Don't kid yourself about that box. That box is going to be a wreck because I'm going to be in it. That was me and those markers. Those markers are going to be a wreck because I'm going to review them. You better get your problems sorted. But yeah, I'm not really feeling them on this paper. They are by far not doing what I'd hoped they were gonna do. And I can't tell if it's, I mean, this red carnation, it doesn't even look like a carnation, this red flower thing, this red blob, it's like very pilling and you can feel the texture and it's still damp. What is that? What is that even? I mean, I'd written into Winsor Newton to find out what the markers were made of because I wanted to find what binders they were using. I wasn't like asking, give me your secret recipe. I just wanted to know so I could, because I'd already tested several pens and none of them were working with them. And I'd like mess around with them in my sketchbook, but I couldn't get them to blend. So I was just kind of curious, like, what paper should I be using? What are these, what holds these together? And the representative told me it was an alcohol-based marker that's water-soluble. Now I'm starting to think that's a different kind of problem. Because at first I was like, well, I'm going to love these, but I'm not going to be able to find a pen. And I can't, if I'm using them with Copic or watercolor, I have to be really careful. And now I'm like, these are taking forever to dry. They don't layer the way I thought they would. Just, you know. Well, I think I'm going to call it with this one because it's not getting better. Color. Just looking, you guys can't see it, but just looking, the colors on the Yupo are so much more vibrant. Probably a paper with a coating, so possibly the Strathmore Plate Bristol, the 500 series Plate Bristol. is going to be a good one for it. And I'm excited to see what Winsor Newton sends me. So this is another paper I bought. This is the Ranger, sorry guys. The Ranger, Distress Watercolor Cardstock. Heavyweight paper for watercolor and wet techniques. And those of you who are familiar with my work know I'm a watercolor artist, and you know I've tested several brands of paper, and you know sometimes I kind of turn my nose up at this kind of stuff, because you could buy a Biggie pad, or I'm sorry, they're called XL pads now. You could buy a Canson XL pad for like $8, you could, which would be 11 by 14, 140 pound watercolor paper, and you would get way more out of it for less than what you're paying for this. So this had better be gold. This had better be like the best watercolor paper, because you've got to overwhelm my implicit watercolor artist bias that you might be taking advantage of people who don't necessarily know better, and that's one of my pet peeves. I don't think that's okay. I don't like it when craft companies release products that don't perform as well, but charge twice as much because they know their clientele doesn't know better. Well, that's kind of cool. It's kind of cool to see the pigment settle into the surface of the paper, which is, I mean, it's a watercolor cardstock, so it's a thin watercolor paper. It's like a 90-pound watercolor paper. It's like student grade watercolor paper in terms of weight. But I mean, you know, it could like totally impress me. It could happen. There have been the Dewcrafts watercolor markers kind of impressed the heck out of me for what they were, for what they charged, for how they performed. I went in thinking they were going to be awful, and they were great. So, or like Crayola Super Tip markers. In using them as a affordable alternative to purchasing watercolor markers, like that impressed me too. So it's possible. I'm not just like this. I am totally an art supply snob, but it's really, I just want supplies that do what they say they're going to do, and are priced fairly. So I mean, I'm going to watercolor on these, and probably do watercolor markers on this paper, and Copics on this paper, because I like to Copic on cold press watercolor paper, sometimes, often. So, I mean, this is not the definitive test. This is just me noodling around and being kind of a jerk. I mean, it's kind of neat, because the texture on watercolor paper causes the pigment marker to skip a little bit in a way I haven't necessarily seen with alcohol-based markers. So it has a more old-fashioned, like a traditional media kind of effect, which is cool. I appreciate that. And the color settles into the paper differently, which is something else I really like. And I have some other watercolor papers that I'm going to test. So if they all perform like this, then we know it's not this particular paper. We know it's that these markers like watercolor paper. However, if they only perform this way on the Tim Holtz watercolor cardstock, I might have to like convert, not entirely over, but I might have to like keep a stash on hand. I mean, that's like the sort of, I mean, that makes me sound like, or I'm kind of similar to the people who only use, like, cotton-based watercolor paper. I mean, there's no, yeah, it works better with watercolors depending on what you want to do, but it does not work better with watercolor markers or water-based markers or alcohol-based markers, because the cotton fibers get chewed up by the nib you're using. So for those kind of applications, you really want, oh, the red's doing a little bit better on this. This seems a little bit more vibrant than the, basically, basically, I'm saying just because the supply doesn't work for best for its like intended application, you should noodle around with it with some other ones. Very scrubby. Because you might realize it's definitely worth keeping around, just not for what everyone else would use it for. And I do still paint often on a wood pulp-based watercolor paper, because it's actually easier to do, for me, it's easier for me to do my comics on the way I want to do my comics, where I have small details, that kind of thing. But it doesn't, you can't do, I find with wood pulp base watercolor paper, you can't really do the beautiful transitions that you could with something like Arches. I'm sorry. I'm being silly, but I'm also trying to decide if the paper is weird, the markers are just weird, because the markers have been weird before on other papers, so I'm already a little inclined to think the markers are just kind of weird, and Winsor & Newton has some kinks to continue working out. But I will say that I'm liking how, and there are aspects that I like about the watercolor paper, or in this case, the watercolor cardstock. I also bought it on Amazon, the paper, because Nashville doesn't have like a scrapbooking specific store. We have a Michaels, and there's a Hobby Lobby that I don't really go to. But there isn't like a store for scrapbookers. So some of the stuff people review that's aimed at crafters and scrapbookers and card makers, it doesn't hit our Michaels. I mean, it took like 2 years for distress markers to come to our Michaels, and by then I'd already ordered them and bought some from another Michaels in a whole other state, and had pretty much written my review for them. It just isn't, it's not up yet. I write posts like 2 months in advance now. I think I've mentioned that. I think I mentioned how it kind of bums me out because I want to talk about stuff and how sometimes I feel like I get scooped because I've written about this and it's in the queue and then somebody else writes about it or blogs about it or does a video on it and I'm just like, I should have released it sooner. I don't want to do a post a day, and I don't want to overwhelm my readers. I want them to be able to, if they're going to, I want them to be able to read the posts and take in what I say. And, you know, I mean, I'm just not trying to spam them is the truth. And there's some weeks where I sneak and I have to put in additional posts because it's like timely or because I'm just too excited about the product to wait too much longer, whatever. And like with the other papers, the cardstock is still damp. It's even causing the cardstock to bubble up a little bit. You guys can't really see. Oh, now you can. Let me pull out. Now you can see it. So, this cardstock didn't suggest stretching it or taping it down, but I suggest stretching it or taping it down if you're going to use the Tim Holtz watercolor cardstock for watercolor applications because it's gonna get all wavy on you because it's not thick enough not to. I mean, really, you could just tape it down with masking tape. Very simple. Not a big deal. You would have to tape down almost, I mean, if you're putting this much water or pigment, I don't know. I don't actually know which of the two is the true problem, because alcohol markers don't cause paper to warp, and they dry almost immediately, even, I'm sure they wouldn't be causing this paper, alcohol markers wouldn't cause this paper to buckle. So I'm assuming it's the markers in this instance. Blend differently than any other alcohol marker I've used before. And they're just different. They're very, very, very different. It's like all this review is gonna end up being. And different can be good. I mean, we've already got plenty of alcohol marker brands to choose from. Okay, so that's the Kim Holtz Distress watercolor cardstock. Didn't bleed through, so that's plus. So it often will bleed through, Copics repeated applications will often bleed through 140-pound watercolor paper. I kind of like how they look on watercolor paper, but the colors are still a little more muted than what they should be based on the colors on the barrel, based on what the colors are able to do on Yupo. So. Alright, here is another watercolor paper. It's Canson Montval watercolor paper. It's 140 pounds. I actually use the big version of this, the 11 by 15 for my comic pages, so I'm very familiar with this paper. It's all right. It's a wood pulp based. It doesn't have a very rough texture for cold press. It's not expensive. I can afford to buy a lot of it to do comic pages on. I pretty much only use it for comic pages, though. I don't use it for standalone illustrations. I use Arches watercolor paper for that. It runs through my printer, so I can print the blue lines on it and pencil those and then stretch it, and the blue lines will wash out. And this is a case where I know I'm using a product that isn't the best, but it does what I need it to do for the thing I needed to do it for, so I'm happy with it. I recommend it if you want to like flirt with doing watercolor comics, because it's affordable. But I don't necessarily recommend it if you want to do like watercolor studies or more serious watercolors. It doesn't fight you the way it doesn't fight you the way the student grade papers will fight you. They'll make it hard for you to do what you need to do. But it also doesn't. You can't do the techniques that you could on a more expensive paper, because it just like immediately sucks up the pigments, and the pigments stain the paper immediately. Man, this nib, look at this nib. Look how like sad that is. That's bad. I mean, if I use the heel of the nib, I'm able to get like actual color, but the front is just ruined. Having a really hard time doing the carnation. I mean, the carnation, it's gonna look bad with me anyway, doing it this way. We've done four now, and I haven't gotten significantly better. This still looks like an eighth grader did it. Maybe a fifth grader. Not the best drawing I've ever done, for sure. That's okay. We're not doing this so you guys can be impressed with my drawing ability. We're doing this so we can find out whether or not the Winsor Newton pigment marker is a good pick for your studio, a good pick for your drawing arsenal. I'm also going to go out on a limb and say, if you don't have any experience using alcohol-based markers, and you don't have any experience using watercolor or water-based markers in a more professional, artistic sense, you should probably get familiar with those first, because this is kind of the worst of both. So I could see being really disappointed if this was like your first marker purchase. Well, I guess I could see you, it would take a long time to get good enough that you're pleased with it, is what I'm really saying. And I do conventions, and I talk to a lot of teenagers at these conventions, and I see a lot of them say how they'd like to be an artist, and they'd like to do art, and they'd like to do the artist alley, but they get so discouraged. You know, everybody's already better than them. And it's like, yeah, but you're 15, you're 16, you've got so much time. It doesn't matter if people are better than you today. You've got years ahead of you, and if you put the dedication in, you're going to get a lot better. I'm also hungry, and I want to eat that Twix, but I don't want a mouthful of food while I'm talking to you guys, because that's kind of gross. I'm also, I don't know, I guess I'm getting kind of bored, because other than a couple of exceptions, everything has performed kind of the same. That's my fault for what I tried to pick things I thought would be a good match. And if I just wanted to set these markers up to fail, I would have just done like plain old sketchbook paper, because it's not designed for any kind of media really other than dry. This is on a gummed pad, so all four of the sides are gummed, so it holds its stretch, it holds it in place. You don't have to stretch it. Unlike a certain watercolor cardstock I looked at, like, a minute ago. And it still wants to buckle. It's not going to buckle because it's holding it tight. Man, I'm not getting better, I'm getting worse. I'm getting, like, less invested in this bouquet. Gonna be able to draw this thing in my sleep. It's still gonna look bad. It's gonna haunt me. Nightmares about this bouquet I can't draw with these markers. This is a marker I ordered. Oh shoot, there we go. I'd ordered from the Dick Blick store, and it came wrapped, it came packaged, and it's getting kind of wrecked too. So, I don't know. I'm like half tempted to be like, guys, write in if you know how to use these things. Tell me what I'm doing wrong. Just be like nice about it. Don't rip me up. Cause I'm just genuinely puzzled right now. No, I'm flubbing illustration wise, and that's okay, but like, I'm also getting frustrated with these markers beyond my own not ability today. I'm getting frustrated because there's pilling, or it could either be the marker fraying, which is bad, or it's the paper tearing, which is just as bad. So it's stuff like that, like, and I was so excited about these markers. I paid a lot of money for them too. So that's like double whammy disappointment when you shell out like $100 for something and you're hoping you can use it regularly. You're hoping you're gonna love it and it's gonna have a permanent home in your studio, but it performs below expectations, or it's difficult to use, or it starts to shred and break. So maybe it's good. They they're not a sponsor of mine because I might have been. I'd like to think I'm not, but I've seen people who can be swayed. I'd like to think bad is bad, you know? Frustrating is frustrating. But I don't think I would be, if I had been given these markers, I think I would be, like, searching harder to find things I liked about it. And now I'm just like, I haven't hit a paper yet that works with these other than Yubo. And, I mean, Yubo is just, like, a weird duck. Anyway, I'm not dismissing it. I'm just like, people who really love Yubo really love Yubo, and people who don't love Yubo are very frustrated by Yubo. Yeah, okay. That's bad. That's on the Canson Montbeau watercolor paper. Okay, so we got 5 finished and like 2 million papers to go. Not really, but enough. Let's try the PM pad because it is a marker paper. I'll zoom out for you guys. I'm really sorry about that glare. I have to have 2 lights because otherwise I get overly strong shadows. Now, PM paper is a very thin marker paper, and the markers, it's got a coating on it, and the marker tends to sit on top. So this might be good for the pigment markers because you can push the pigments around more, kind of like the Yubo, but it should have a faster drying time. Although we've already seen that on watercolor paper, which is designed to absorb water, the markers are still very, laying down a very wet application that takes a really long time to dry. So, I don't know, this could go either way. And I've used this with Copics, and I've liked it with Copics. I can't do as many layers as I would normally do, but that's not really the point of today's little experiment. I'll try to slow my roll, maybe produce something that doesn't look horrible. So they definitely sit on the paper surface a little bit more than they were sitting on the paper surface for the other watercolor papers and the crescent renderer paper and the crescent marker board I showed you guys. And it might bleed through, it might ruin the page underneath, and I'll be sad. Or angry at myself for not putting a piece of cardstock underneath. So for those of you who record video, do you ever start a video and you're like, this is going to take hardly any time, and I'll just eat lunch after, and it ends up taking a while, and you are wishing you'd eaten lunch after all, and you're hungry, and all you can think about is food, and having lunch and food? Don't lie. I'm sure some of you guys, when you first started recording, you goofed, just the way I goof. Man, it is really, I might end up using that bullet nib I said I wasn't going to use, because I hate bullet nibs. At least it's less tedious. On the watercolor paper, other than my initial, oh look, the pigments settle differently in the cracks. Other than that initial response, it was like, tedious and kind of boring, because it just wasn't reacting the way I felt like it should. And now it's working a little bit better, so PM pad is a better option for these. Because it's going to dry, Yubo's going to take forever. It'll dry, but it'll also your pigments are going to stay on the surface of the paper, so you can mix them a little easier, reactivate them a little bit easier. And it also doesn't take as much ink. That is a problem with rendering on watercolor paper, is it takes a lot of alcohol-based marker to, like, render on. It just, it's thirsty paper, and it's going to take your ink. Whereas this kind of paper is a little less thirsty. Although it is causing the paper to buckle. You can't really see it, but that's not good. Not really something you want with a... Yeah, and as you can see, it's already starting to bleed through. I think I'm going to grab a piece of cardstock, slip under it, so that doesn't continue. Oh, my marker fell! Quit it! There. It's actually just two sheets of regular paper. Couldn't find cardstock. You can also render details a little bit better than you could on the Yupo or the cardstock. I'm sure when I try to do that carnation, I'm going to be so disappointed. That carnation is like my bane. And the fact that my nibs are getting kind of like mushy and awful, even though I've been using, other than two watercolor papers, I've been using smooth paper. That's frustrating and a tick against Winsor & Newton pigment markers. So it is looking like colors are layering, but they're not blending. I mean, I really don't, I haven't pulled out the colorless blender yet. I actually prefer blending marker to marker rather than like blending out dark colors with a lighter color than using colorless blender, because it often makes, in my opinion, it makes what you've rendered look very gray. And I use colorless blender in my marker tests because I know most people use it at some point. Oh, another perk of these markers is they're supposed to be color fast for 100 years, which is, it's interesting, and I'm going to test that, because I don't know how I feel about it. I don't know how much I trust it. But, alcohol markers use dye, other than these, and dye is light fugitive, so suppose when things are light fugitive, when you leave them in the sun or under bright lights, they fade over time. So if you've purchased a commission, or if you're doing a commission for someone and they're going to display it in their house, that's something you need to think about. And I actually, if I get enough money in donations, I can afford to do this. I would like to do like basic primary color light fastness across several popular marker brands. And I'd like to include these, and I mean, I have a sunning window and everything. Just needs to happen. Needs to get funded. And that was something one of my readers requested on my Twitter, and I thought that was a really good idea. I think it's something we don't actually think about enough. Man, the paper is really not taking it super well. At least it's easier to render on. But, I mean, when I do my marker tests, I don't actually buy... I buy skin tones and colors that if I like the markers, I can end up using in conjunction with my Copics. So I don't actually buy primaries for all the brands I test. I have some primaries, like I have the Chameleon primary set, and I have the big sets of the fine color markers. So there's primaries in there, I think. They're fashion markers, so they have a lot of skin tones. They might not actually have many primaries. But like with Prismacolors, I'm just buying the colors I need. And with the Mexby markers, I might have enough primaries, but I doubt it. And if it sweetens the pot any, I was willing to sell or give away the markers from that test that aren't part of my personal collection. So the markers I purchased for the test. We'll see. I was going to organize a Patreon this month. Actually, I said November, and I might still. For the blog and for the YouTube channel, just to like help offset some of the costs, and also to better foster a community. I mean, I've been doing it for several years, and I guess I just fought the Patreon thing. I think Patreon's a great idea, but like, I make comics. I make comics for kids. And so many of my comic peers, when I mentioned working on the blog, they're like, well, that doesn't count. You know, that's not good enough. That doesn't count. You need to have a webcomic instead. And I like webcomics. I think they're great. I just wanted to finish all of Kara, because Kara's watercolor, and it's a really time-consuming comic, and it's a comic for kids. I wanted to finish all that and then release it online in case something happened to me. I don't know, I think it's sad when comic artists' life happens and they just kind of have to abandon their projects, and I didn't want to do that with a comic meant for kids. I know they get invested. I know adults get invested, but I think it's harder for kids. Like, how do you explain, well, my job, you know, like, to a kid, that's just sad excuses. That's not good enough. I didn't want to do that to them. So even though I have a comic that I work on, and I've been writing the blog with the ArtSpy reviews and the convention reviews as kind of like a way to stay visible the way somebody might do with a webcomic. I guess that's not good enough for a lot of people. So I shouldn't have allowed that to affect how I felt about it, but I did. And then I had, and still have, a lot of trouble getting my readers to interact with me. It's hard to get them to answer questions like what tutorials they would like. And I have the page views. I know people read it. They're just very, very shy. And I'm very shy, and I have anxiety problems. So when they do reach out to me, sometimes it takes me months to get back to them because I'm just so overwhelmed. I mean, I'm really appreciative of the ones who do write back to me. I don't want it to sound like I'm complaining. It's just, we've got connection problems is the issue. And I was kind of hoping a Patreon might provide like a visual representation of how much things cost and how few people actually do help contribute for the content that they're consuming. And it would also give them, I mean, I have a poll. Every 2 weeks I do a new poll to ask readers what they would like, but it would also allow me to very easily send out rewards based on donations. I just think it would enable a richer relationship, and I held off for a really long time because I was like, well, nobody's gonna contribute. I mean, I can't get them to donate now. I can't even get them to comment. I can't, if we're at the same con and I taught them how to table in a panel, I can't even get them to come over and say hi. I'm like the invisible woman. But I mean, you don't gain anything if you don't take any risks. It's time to do what it takes to get that rolling. I'd like to start having like live stream sessions, and I'd like to like be able to draw gift art and fan art for my backers. Like, I really would like that connection. That was the reason I started this in the first place, was to stay visible and to contribute to the art and comic community as a whole, and to just like be a participant. But I'm the kind of person who needs feedback, and I'm not necessarily getting the kind of feedback I need. I guess I'm hoping a Patreon might help me bridge that gap. And that's part of the reason I decided I was going to up. I mean, I've done YouTube videos for a while. Joseph does interviews with artists at shows, right? And, like, we post them, and then nobody looks at them. And we can't even get the artist sometimes to promote their own interview. So I was hoping that by increasing my content and doing reviews and that kind of stuff, it might help change some things. We'll see. We'll find out, right? I'm sorry, I've been talking about personal stuff with you guys a lot and not talking about these markers, but I feel like I'd said the things that needed to be said, and now I'm just, like, messing around with them. I mean, it's, even though this is marker paper, it's still having some of the same problems the other papers I've tested. I don't know, I guess I'm really excited to see what Winsor & Newton sends out in the mail. Because I really, really want these to work. I've already bought a bunch of them. I've got some coming in the mail. Like, I don't want to just write this off as a failed experiment like a lot of the supplies I buy end up being. But what about you guys? How many of you do reviews too? How many of you do tutorials? You should comment and leave me a link. I would really love to check them out, and I'd love to link them and help promote them, because we gotta watch each other's backs. We gotta take care of each other. And I would love to use what I've got to help you. I mean, it would be really great if the return happened as well, if you guys signal boosted or promoted some of my videos. I would really appreciate it, because the way you grow your audience is through other people being like, yeah, I follow so-and-so, and they're great. I like their stuff. Like, people purchase by word of mouth. People watch by word of mouth. Okay, so this was the Copic PM pad, which is an alcohol marker paper that is very thin and a bit translucent. There was a little bit of bleed through, but it didn't bleed through to the paper underneath, so that's good on this paper. But as with so many of the other papers, the colors are not as vibrant as they are on the Yupo. So that's kind of a shame. And I think I'm going to use the 400 series mixed media paper instead of doing the 400 series and the 500 series, because the 500 series is kind of an expensive paper and I'm already getting kind of poor results. And 400 series is very good mixed media paper with Strathmore. It's smooth, it's like Bristol board, it's thick. I don't think there's a coating on it. It shouldn't bleed through. I only have like 6 boards of the 500 series, and I'd really rather use it with a product that gives better results than these are giving me today. So, and if you guys really want to see it on the 600 series paper, I will revisit it. But I am going to skip it today because I'm losing my voice and I'm hungry. And the markers are kind of getting goopy on me. Or if you have a webcomic, I'd like to promote it. Or a print comic that isn't that... I mean, my comic focuses kids media specifically, comics for girls even more specifically. So if you have a comic that is for teenage girls or for women or for little boys, like, I would love to promote your work, because us kids slash female creators, again, we gotta have each other's backs. It's often very hard for our work to get noticed out there. And when you're doing kids' comics, especially self-published kids' comics, it doesn't seem like there's a place for your work. I'm speaking personally. I did ALA this year, and it was a bust. But everybody I talked to said that this year's ALA was kind of a bust in terms of sales. Unless you had a publisher who was kind of helping your costs. And I don't. I have me. I'm my publisher right now. So I had to eat those costs. But I had a good time in San Francisco. I love visiting San Francisco. I have a couple friends over there. I didn't stay with them, of course. I had to pay for a hotel. I paid for a hotel room because it was business. And because I would have been, like, in and out. And I would have been kind of a poor guest. And I also, I do anime cons where my work is pretty well received. And I do a lot of indie cons, which is a mixed bag. Like, I did Handmade and Bound in Nashville, and I did really well. It was a little one-day indie all kinds of stuff, like indie prints, indie illustration, indie comics. I did that, and it went better than I thought. And I did Free Comic Book Day in Nashville, and it went pretty well, too. I mean, like, not, like, bonkers, but, like, I certainly had a good time. I enjoyed talking to people. I met a lot of cool people. But then I do big shows like Mocha or SPX or TCAF, and they're kind of terrible for me. I mean, location is important, and my location has not been really great for those shows, but they're also just expensive shows. It's expensive to fly to New York. It's expensive to fly to Canada. It's expensive to drive. It's expensive to fly to DC. It's expensive to stay in those areas. And because those are cons that, like, are kind of on the, well, you have to do it list, try it once in your life list, like, everybody goes there, and it's just so packed. It's so packed that people can't even get to the tables to, like, look at your stuff. So what they do, especially if parents, they make a list of the names they know that they want to hit up, and they hit those names, and then they leave. So if you're somebody like me who's having kind of a hard time getting traction, it hasn't been worth my money. And I also don't have a lot of I have friends, but the years I can afford to go, they can't afford to go, and vice versa. So it's not like it's, like, the best hangout con for me. Like, honestly, some little anime con in, like, Nashville, MTAC's big, but I'm talking, like, an anime con in a city that one of us lives in, or a city that's cheap, would be better for a hangout con, and I'd probably make more money. But I mean, because my comic is for kids, and most anime conventions cater to teens, it has the appeal of, like, being kind of Ghibli-esque, my comic. So that I sell okay. I sell pretty good. I mean, I'm happy with it. It could always be better. I mean, I think any artist who has a comic would way rather their comic be the big seller than anything else on their table. And I sell, like, original fan art watercolors and, like, stuff I make, and bags, and, you know, like, whatever inspiration, charms, usually. This year we're doing wooden charms. You know, whatever inspiration strikes, I try to stay competitive with the other artists. I try to not rely too much on fan art being my moneymaker, because I don't want to pay my bills with somebody else's hard work. That's how I feel personally as a comic artist, right? Because, like, I am working hard to make my own stuff too. I want that to be the draw, not the da-ra-ra-ra I drew, or Danganronpa. And I also only do fan art for stuff I genuinely like and care about, so I can talk, but then I get to have, like, a genuine interaction with the people who are buying it. Be like, oh, I love that too. And I'll probably record me painting Kara. I'm on chapter 6 now, and the friends he's visiting, one of them is a comic artist too. He's kind of like my little kohai, except he's, like, way taller than me, so he's, like, my big kohai. And I've kind of, like, shared what I can with him, shared my experience. And he might be doing a video for you guys using Copic markers for, I'm not super sure if he's doing, like, a mech, or if he's going to do, like, a muscly dude or whatever, but it's going to be totally different from what I do. And I thought that would be cool for y'all. I should talk about the paper and these things instead of just rattling on. No bleed through. Kind of grayed out. Soaks into the paper so you can't push the pigments as much. Anyway, I was gonna have my friend and his girlfriend, who's actually my really good friend from high school. We've been friends for years, so she's kind of like my little sister. I was going to have them read through chapter 6, the thumbnails, and see what kind of suggestions, corrections they had. Trying to polish the chapter as much before I always try to do that. It doesn't always work out. But chapter 5, chapter 6, book 2, they're part of book 2. Book 1 is out. You can buy it in my shop. You can buy it from me at Shoes. You can email me and buy a copy. There's probably an annotation right there where you could find it. Book 1 is out, and so one of the problems is it's a tiny people story, and the very first thing people say is, oh, like the Borrowers. I mean, it's got tiny people, and it's got humans in it, and that's about that, right? Like, I grew up reading tiny people stories. I love stories about tiny people. There's more than just the Borrowers. And anyway, it's more like Little House on the Prairie, with that meets a modern-day setting kind of thing, than it is like the Borrowers, right? So it's not my favorite. Or like Arrietty. Oh, it's like Arrietty! No. Not really. I mean, of course it was inspired by these things, because you read those things and you like the genre. Like, I like tiny things. I played with dolls. I made dollhouse furniture. I made dollhouse furnishings. I made doll clothes for years. I still do it sometimes. I like doing it. I like tiny miniature things. I think they're really cool. But gosh, I lost my train of thought. Like it's just kind of frustrating. And like, the whole reason somebody like me would make a book like that is because I'd read all of these stories about like elves and brownies and pixies and little people and the fae and Borrowers, and I always felt like there were holes. There were things I wanted to see that never seemed to come up. And so I started brainstorming 7-inch Kara a few months before Studio Ghibli announced in Japan that they were doing Arrietty. And when I heard the news, I was kind of annoyed because I'd already done all this concept for it. I'd already got my heart set. And I mean, I thought about finding another project, but I mean, I just done like a really horrific semester at SCAD. And I'd like come to the realization that if I was gonna fail, I wanted to fail on my own merits. Not fail the class, but fail as an artist, fail as a comic creator. I wanted to fail on my own merits, and I wanted to fail doing the things I thought were important. And I was also working on my thesis at the time, which was on children's comics and how panel layout affects reading comprehension. And so I decided I was going to pursue it because I felt like I had things to say that weren't being said. And the main theme of 7-inch Kara, I'm gonna spoil it. No, I'm not. But it might, I don't know. It's that people with power, and power is implied by size, physical size. People with power, even if their intentions are the best, they force their will on those who are smaller and weaker than them because they assume they know better. So, not like the Borrowers at all. But book one was all about like setting up the world and setting up the house and setting up Kara as a character. And I kind of released it earlier than I would have liked because so many people I knew, so many comic people I knew, assumed I didn't make comics because I'm not releasing it online. And even though I was like selling individual chapters at shows, I thought having a perfect bound book on my table might do better. And I mean, come on, when you're working so hard on a comic and you're not getting paid to work on it and you're just like sacrificing a lot for it, you really want to be able to share it with people. You want to show it to people. This is terrible. I'm too busy talking excitedly to you guys about my stuff. And I thought releasing print copies of Kara as I work on the story would give me something to show people. It would give me something to show potential employers. It would give me something for my resume. It would give me a sense of completion and validation. Like, all this work I'd put into this comic was worth it. And it would mean I didn't have to wait 5 years before I could show people the bulk of what I was doing. But the problem with book one is people who are like kind of casually familiar with tiny people stories and the tiny people trope, like they've read the Borrowers or they've seen the Borrowers and that's it. That's their knowledge of it. They like write Kara off entirely as just being a derivative work of that without actually knowing anything about the genre, and that's been really kind of detrimental. I mean, it's been good in some ways because it's made me mad, and it made me mad enough to, like, change a lot of things so the story's stronger. But it was also just like, dang, I wish you wouldn't assume Volume 1 was a standalone volume when it says in the back that there are more books coming. But I mean, things that you have to learn in real life that you can't, that aren't told to you in art school. So, that's the 400 series. Got a lot of the same problems that the other papers have. I'm putting away my markers right now. I guess you guys can't see that. To make room on my desk so I can pull all the other papers I tested these things out on so you guys could see. You could have a visual comparison. Okay, so 400 series Strathmore multimedia paper, which is paper that should work, sorry about the tilting, with ink, it should work with markers, it should work with watercolor. There wasn't significant buckling, it's a little bit thicker. Next up is the crescent board. So actually the reds are a little bit darker, a little less gray, but there's a lot more paper pilling, whereas there's no paper pilling on here. Canson Montvol watercolor paper, very gray, some paper pilling. The paper was pulling, like buckling, but you get a little bit of interesting color variation by what settles into the texture of the paper and what sits on top. Harder to blend. Sorry about the old lady noises. Copic PM paper, kind of like middle of the road in terms of color saturation, was easier to do details on, harder to do large even fills on. Ink dried a little bit quicker. There is some paper pilling with successive layers, or like a scrub texture, which is very commonly used to apply color evenly with alcohol-based markers. Does not work with the pigment markers because it just kind of pushes the pigment buildup around. What are you? Okay. Crescent render paper. So this is the crescent marker board. This is the crescent render paper. I'd actually use some of the opaque white on the render paper, but it's coming up more as like a butter color than a white because it picks up that pigment. Paper pilling on the crescent paper. It's not as thick as the crescent board. Colors aren't as vibrant as the crescent board. This is the Tim Holtz Distress watercolor paper. I'm sorry, watercolor cardstock, which is a thin watercolor cardstock. It looks like there's a texture on both sides, so it looks like it might have been mold made. It might actually be watercolor paper, just marketed not as watercolor paper, which I don't understand. Colors are a little more vibrant on this. Because there's more texture, the pigment can settle into the crevices, so you get more color variation. And lastly, Yupo, which in my opinion is the most vibrant. It's the most exciting. It's also the most difficult to work with, most difficult to control, very gestural, very loose. The colors don't soak into the paper, so you're seeing the white of the paper bouncing like through the colors. So they're brighter than they are on any of the other papers we've done. I'm sorry, it's more apparent in person than it is on camera, and I don't think it's necessarily the lighting, because I have a natural light lamp on one side and an LED lamp on the other, so my colors are pretty true in the studio. But anyway, I had the most fun painting on the Yupo paper, and it gives the most interesting effects, but I found these markers to be difficult to control, and I'm going to try some other things, but for now that's this video. I'm holding off on giving an opinion on Winsor & Newton pigment markers until the Winsor & Newton Winsor & Newton marker paper comes in and my skin tone set comes in. I'm sorry, I'm holding you guys hostage. and I try inking and then coloring that. I mean, I'm going to really give these a fighting chance because I think using a pigment and an alcohol marker that is also water soluble is a really interesting idea, and I want to see the kinks get worked out because I want these to be a product that people have access to. If you guys have any suggestions, or if I've done something glaringly wrong and you know it and you can tell me how to fix it, I would love to hear from you. If you have an art supply review blog that you'd like me to check out and promote, leave a comment or send me an email. I hope you guys have a good day. Bye.